Good morning, Tigers. Welcome to the Tech Morning Show.
My name is Kylie McClintock.
My name is Jonathan Hayworth.
My name is Shayla Wileski.
My name is Victoria Voles.
My name is Muhammad Salah.
Good morning, Tigers. My name is Roman Jordan.
Good morning, Tigers. My name is Bashara Muhammad.
Hi, I'm Ella Gorkuber.
Hey, Tigers. I'm Chloe Mackey.
Welcome back, Tigers.
Can you believe it? We're already back in school.
And we're in season 3.
We have a lot of exciting things planned for you today.
Check out this segment about the first week of school.
First things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh,
Hey Tigers, my name is Alejandro Cisneros, and here's a shout out to National Hispanic Heritage Month. Check out this video to learn more.
Hi everybody, my name is Yesenia, and I'm excited to celebrate Hispanic heritage and all of our Hispanic communities here at Kaplan. To spice up your life, here are a few fun facts about Hispanic Heritage Month.
Numero uno. Every year, Americans observe National Hispanic Heritage Month from September 15th through October 15th. Recognizing the contributions made and the important presence of Hispanics and Latin Americans in the United States while celebrating their heritage and their culture.
Numero dos, former President LBJ first began celebrating Hispanic heritage on a national level with Hispanic Heritage Week in 1968.
Numero tres, 20 years later in 1988, President Ronald Reagan expanded the celebration to be a month long.
Numero cuatro, September 15th was chosen to commemorate the start of Hispanic Heritage Month because it's the anniversary of the independence of 5 Latin American countries, Costa Rica, El Salvador, Guatemala, Honduras, and Nicaragua.
Numero cinco, Mexico celebrates their Independence Day on September 16th, while Chile celebrates on September 18th.
Numero seis, Hispanic Heritage Month pays tribute to the generations of Hispanic Americans who have positively influenced and enriched our nation and society.
We're excited to share more about these beautiful cultures with all of you. Stay tuned for more education and fun. And remember, Happy Hispanic Heritage Month, everyone.
Happy Hispanic Heritage Month.
Happy Hispanic Heritage Month, everybody.
Gracias por ver. Espero que tienen una buena día.
If you want to be part of the Tech Morning Show, check out this information to learn more.
Hey students, so we weren't alive
20 years ago when 9/11 happened. However, our teachers were. Here's a special segment about their experiences.
Well, 20 years ago from 9/11, wow, it's, you know, 9/11 is one of those events for me that is life-changing. You remember every single minute that was happening throughout that day during that event.
I was at home with my then 2-year-old son.
I was 16 years old. I was a junior here at Tech.
It was a really surreal morning because I was in college.
I was in Kent, Washington. It was my first day of ninth grade at Kent Junior High.
I remember when we first got the call, I was working at a lawn mowing company on September 11th.
I was 25 years old. I was teaching in the state of Maryland, just outside of Washington, D.C.
So yeah, I was in ninth grade. I was in an Algebra 2 class, actually.
I had just had my third child and was sitting on the couch with her. She was a month old and watching the news.
I was a junior in high school. I remember that morning. Who could forget?
Well, I was at North Junior High as an eighth grader. I was 14.
I was walking into my first period class, which was Mr. Martig, and he's a U.S. history teacher, and he had the TV on, and the first plane had already hit at this point.
And I remember my aunt down in Kent, Washington, driving to my first day of school, and it came over the radio.
I didn't have the TVs on while we were working in class, but I got a knock at the door from the teacher next door, Mrs. Warren. And Mrs. Warren said, "Did you hear what just happened? Did you hear what just happened?" I said, "No." She said, "A plane just hit one of the Twin Towers in New York City."
It didn't even look real. Like, it looked like someone had just kind of made this video and it was being shown. And it took me a while to figure out, one, what I was seeing, and one, how could it possibly be happening?
When I got to school, the first plane had actually already gone in. And the first thing, it was so weird because I went into school and every class had a TV, and it was up on there, and there was just smoke coming out of this place. And my brother had moved to New York about 3 years earlier.
I'm originally from New York. I grew up in upstate New York, and I had family in New York City, but I did not, I did not make a connection with anything that was seriously going wrong at the moment.
And as we were sitting in front of the TV, the second plane hit the tower. And all I remember is reaching over and grabbing my son Jacob and putting him on my lap and processing everything.
I can remember sitting there watching, and we watched the second plane hit.
So more and more students started to come sit down and started to come watch what was happening on the news. And eventually we had almost the whole class when the second plane hit the South Tower. And then it got real scary.
My first thoughts were, we're under attack. And I looked down at my daughter and said, I just thought, why did I bring this baby into this world?
I just remember that feeling of like somebody has invaded our country and done this on our soil, you know?
And I just remember feeling an additional anxiety to my first day of school. And I walked right in with my school uniform and my hijab on.
So we were all sitting down, just completely quiet, watching the stories unfold. And then the Pentagon got hit. And then it became even scarier. We were just outside of Washington, D.C. When the Pentagon got hit, one of the students raises his hand. His name was Josh. He raised his hand, and he goes, can I go to the office? And I said, are you okay? And he said, I don't know. He said, my dad works in the Pentagon. I need to find out if he's okay. I said, go, just go. Again, the students didn't have cell phones. So it's not like, and even if they tried to connect, you know, the cell phones, the cell towers were overloaded.
How is this happening? And I couldn't even take it, like I said, I was just surreal. Like, you couldn't even take it in. Because you don't imagine these situations. It's not something you really think about.
And then they bring up the news, the White House is being evacuated. And I had a female raise her hand in my class. Her name was Shelly. She raised her hand and she goes, can I go to the office? I need to find out if my mom's okay. My mom works in the White House. And I'm like, absolutely, go.
United 93, understand, have a bomb on board, go ahead.
I feel it's gonna come down too.
And this person that we were mowing their house, it was a house in Maple Grove. The man came running out with his little white dog, and he came out and he was like, the buildings are falling. Oh, dear, they're falling. He's like, America is under attack. And we had no idea. We were just mowing his lawn, and we had no idea what he was talking about. So then he pulled us aside to tell us what was happening. But, of course, we had to keep mowing. So then we changed the station in the radio in between the next job and the next job and the next job all day long. We just listened to it on the radio as it was unfolding.
The part that hits me the hardest was that my brother, we couldn't get a hold of my brother because the cell towers were just completely packed the entire day. And we didn't actually get to talk to him until the day after.
There were still planes in the air at this time. They were trying, air traffic control was grounding all the planes. And now the military has released F-16s. What's kind of crazy is we could open up the back door of our classroom and watch the F-16s flying over, circling D.C., and knowing that if anything comes into that territory, they're going to get shot down. And you could hear them. You just hear the jets buzzing by.
And then throughout the day, we could go to rooms that had TVs in it and just find out what was happening. I can remember being scared. I know my family had a lot of friends who were pilots, so finding out that they were okay was the main thing. And just sad for all that life that was lost.
So we're watching this again, and just as things were happening, we heard of eventually hearing of the other plane that went down in Pennsylvania, that was brought down in Pennsylvania, that was heading towards 10 toward DC. And so the class were, all high school students were in tears. They were angry. There's all this emotion happening. So eventually the principal came into our room. He was going room to room, and he had to shut down the television. He said, "We got to turn it off. We're under a state of emergency in the state of Maryland. All schools are being shut down, and we're sending the kids home, and we're working on transportation right now, and we're working on a plan to get all the students home and to be with family."
Thousands of lives were suddenly ended by evil, despicable acts of terror. These acts shatter steel, but they cannot dent the steel of American resolve.
After it happened, my life felt so different in that everybody like came together and everybody was so patriotic and so for America, and people just came together, and the kindness that everybody was exhibiting toward each other was just beautiful.
Our class was brought together. We were brought together and we were just so much closer having lived through watching this event live. Eventually, a few hours later, we were all home. And my neighbor works three blocks from the Pentagon. And I was just talking with his wife. Everybody in the whole neighborhood was outside talking and just communicating with each other, just giving each other hugs. And my neighbor comes home and eventually pulls in, and it was like, he said, it's just crazy. It's chaotic. And he was fine. He was okay. But he said DC was just a mess.
But I remember the following weeks of 9/11, taking off my hijab and going to school with my hair just styled and trying to avoid any connection to my Muslim Islamic background. And I remember my language arts teacher in ninth grade just handing me a sticky note telling me how beautiful I am on the inside and out, with or without my hijab, and that I'm always welcome to see her after class. And then the following week, we were reading Elie Wiesel's Night, and I remember just that having a greater meaning for me at that time, and just immersing myself in the world of Elie Wiesel and indifference and acceptance and love. And everything was just heightened, and I was able to find my identity and my role in this world following the 3 weeks following 9/11. It was a pivotal moment for me as a student and as a Muslim American for the rest of my life. Up to this point, I credit that point to helping me be where I am today.
And the thing that absolutely stands in my mind and is just burned into my mind is the next time we went to New York to visit my brother. We went there and we were stuck about a block and a half off of the World Trade Center area. And we were just standing there dumbfounded because there's nothing there. There's just nothing there.
Thank you for watching, Tigers, and have a great day.
Thank you, Tigers. Stay safe.
Don't forget, Tigers, make sure you're wearing your mask and don't forget to wash your hands.
Thanks, Tigers. Have a great day.
Take care, Tigers.
Thanks for watching, Tigers. See you next week.